product of your knowledge. And we began to look at the fact that there is an evil conscience, and then there is a conscience or a heart that is established in grace. The word of God tells us that your heart be established with grace and not with meat. And then we began to look at all of that. And the book of Hebrews, where we read last, Hebrews chapter 10 verse 22, he said, let us draw now with a true heart in full assurance of faith. In full assurance, not in partial assurance, not in doubting assurance, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. So our hearts are sprinkled from an evil conscience. What is an evil conscience? Is a conscience that is suffering from sin consciousness. Sin consciousness. So we have to have that evil conscience purged out of our heart. That is a consciousness that is confused. That is a consciousness that doesn't know whether it is God or it is not God. That is a consciousness that says sometimes God is good, sometimes God is bad. That is a consciousness that says sometimes God punishes people with evil and sometimes God delivers people with from evil. It's an evil conscience, and that conscience has to be purged. And now we began to talk about how do you assure your heart? How do you, because you are the one to assure your heart. He said, let us come with a true heart and in full assurance of faith. You are the one to assure your heart before Christ, before God. So how do we therefore assure our hearts? Hebrews chapter 1 verse 2. If you have a good Bible, Hebrews chapter 1 verse 2. Hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. Verse 3. Who being the brightness of his glory, and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. So we see that God has spoken to us in his Son. The Son is the Word, and we have to focus our eyes on the Son, who is the Word. We assure our hearts by focusing on the Son who has purged all our sins. Hebrews chapter 3 verse 1. How do we assure our hearts? We are for holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus. Consider Jesus. Consider Jesus. That is to say, be taught, let your thought be full of Jesus. To consider Jesus means to be thought full. That is, your mind should not think about you. Your mind should think about Jesus. Your mind should not focus on what you can do. Your mind should focus on what Jesus has done. You assure your heart by considering Jesus, not considering your circumstances. Abraham considered not. He didn't consider what he was capable of producing. He considered Jesus. Hebrews chapter 2 verse 9. Hebrews chapter 2 verse 9. But we see Jesus. That's all to see. Don't see yourself. Don't see your weakness. Don't see your failure. Don't see your inability. Don't see your capability of or lack of it. We see Jesus. That's what we see. We consider Jesus. That's what we consider. We focus on the Word who has purged our sins. That is how to assure our hearts. We assure our hearts on the platform of what Jesus has done. Outside of what Jesus has done, you have no assurance. The only assurance you have is built on what Jesus has done. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 14. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 14. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. Let us see that we have a great high priest, Jesus the Son of God. We focus our hearts on Jesus the Son of God, our great high priest. That is how to assure our hearts. Hebrews chapter 5 verse 8. Hebrews chapter 5 verse 8. Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. Verse 9. And being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him, or unto all they that believe him. Unto all they that believe him. Go back to verse 9. Unto all they that believe him. He is made perfect, and he has become the author of eternal salvation. So we look up to him so that our conscience stays on the altar of eternal salvation. We look up, and as we keep looking, our hearts get assured in what he has done for us. The book of Hebrews chapter 6 verse 19. Hebrews chapter 6 verse 19. Which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which entereth in to that within the veil. He is the anchor. You know the meaning of an anchor. When you bring a ship to birth, there has to be an anchor to anchor the ship, to give the ship stability. No matter the waves and the winds in the sea, once a ship is anchored, no matter what blows, it stays there. Jesus is the anchor of our faith. Therefore, when you keep looking up to him, your heart is assured. No matter the wind, no matter the storms, no matter the trials, no matter the temptations, your heart is fixed on him. Your heart is assured, and that delivers you from a sin consciousness. I'm teaching. He is the anchor. He's the stabilizer. When our hearts stay on him, we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and that which entereth into that within the veil. The book of Hebrews chapter 6 verse 20, where we are, he says there, verse 20, 6:20, whither the forerunner is for us entered, even Jesus, that's the anchor, Jesus made a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. That is the anchor for the assuring of our soul, that once we look up to him, no matter what blows, our heart is assured. Somebody shout, I hear you. The book of Hebrews chapter 7 verse 25. He has gone for us a forerunner to anchor our soul. Hebrews 7:25. Wherefore he is able to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. He ever liveth to make intercession for them. The word uttermost means once and forever. He is able to save them once and forever. That's the meaning of uttermost. So since he's the one saving you once and forever, for you to assure your heart, you must focus on him. You focus on him to assure your heart. You focus on him to keep your heart free from sin consciousness. I must see Jesus living and making intercession for me. Once I see that, then every fear goes, because he is the anchor of my soul. Hebrews chapter 8 verse 1. Hebrews chapter 8 verse 1. Now of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such a high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. We focus on that high priest that is set there on the right hand of the majesty of the throne in heaven. We put our mind there. We keep our gaze there. We keep our focus there. Anytime the enemy tries to make you take your eyes from Jesus, he is trying to bring sin consciousness. You refuse to take your eye. You focus your eye. I'm taking you chapter by chapter to see that the focus that assures our heart is Jesus and his finished work. Outside of that, you'll be a victim of sin consciousness. Outside of that, you'll be a victim of condemnation. Outside of that, you'll be a victim of guilt. Outside of focusing on Jesus. Hebrews chapter 9 verse 14. Hebrews chapter 9 verse 14. Now much more, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. He purges your conscience. As long as your eyes are fixed on him, your conscience stays constantly kept, assured, through the eternal spirit offered himself without spot. Once your heart stays on him, your conscience, your heart is assured. Hebrews chapter 10 verse 12. Hebrews chapter 10 verse 12. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God. Verse 13. From henceforth, expecting till his enemies be made his footstool. Verse 14. For by one offering, he had perfected forever them that are sanctified. By one offering, he has perfected. So as you stay on him, you stay in perfection. When you take your eyes from him, guilt and condemnation, which is an evil conscience. As long as you stay on him. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 2. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Looking unto Jesus. There's nobody to look unto, only Jesus. When you look up to him, your heart is assured. He said, we shall assure our hearts. We are the ones to assure. And now he shows us how to assure our hearts from guilt, from condemnation, from an evil conscience. Hebrews chapter 13 verse 8. Hebrews chapter 13 verse 8. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. That means he is the perfect offering and the perfect sacrifice. The same yesterday, today and forever. The perfect offering and the perfect sacrifice. Verse 9. Contextually, verse 9. Be not carried about with diverse and strange doctrines. Don't let yourself to be carried about with diverse and strange doctrines. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Therefore, don't let anybody razzmatize you and carry you about with diverse doctrines. For it is a good thing that the heart be established with grace. The message of grace. That your heart be established with grace. Not what you can do. Not what, how much you can live right. Your heart should not be established on your efforts. It should be established with grace and not with meat, which have not profited them that have been occupied therein. Meat does not profit. It doesn't profit. It's of no eternal value. So let your heart be established with grace. Am I teaching here? Your heart be established with what? Grace. Look at chapter 13 of Hebrews, verse 20. This is why your heart should be established with grace. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant. Next verse. Make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you. He's the one working. He's the one working in you. You're not the one working. That's why your heart should be established with grace. Don't be carried away. Don't let yourself to be carried away with diverse doctrines. Let your heart be established with grace. Why? That God will make you perfect in every good work to do his will. Even the doing of his will, he's the one that will move you to that. To do his will. Working in you. Who is working? Talk to me, church. Who is working? He's the one working. Working in you, that which is well pleasing in his sight. You're not the one working. He's the one working in you, that which is pleasing in his sight. When your heart is established with grace. The scriptures are so clear. Very clear. Working in you, that which is well pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ. The work is through Jesus Christ. We assure our hearts. The work is through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Can somebody shout hallelujah? Jesus is the great shepherd of the sheep. So the writer of Hebrews was charging the audience to fix their thoughts on Christ. From chapter 1 where we started to chapter 13, the entire message of Hebrews is to fix your thoughts on Christ, that you be established in the doctrine of Christ, not with diverse doctrines carried away, that your heart be single-minded on Christ, that you refuse to let all kinds of philosophies and all kinds of religious razzmatazz and all kinds of confused teachings to move your heart from Christ, because that is where you assure your heart. Assure your heart. We assure our hearts. Our hearts condemn us only if we expose it to anything that is not Christ. Because if our heart is on Christ, Christ will tell you, neither do I condemn you. But when your heart leaves Christ, there will be condemnation. So to be free from condemnation and sin consciousness, set your heart on Christ. Teaching good. When you start thinking about how much you need to pray, when you start taking the credit of the finished work of Christ and putting it on your effort in prayer, when you start calculating how hard you have tried as a Christian for 3 years now, you have not cheated anybody. When you start doing that, you will soon be a victim of sin consciousness, because of necessity, you will miss it somewhere. Satan will capitalize on that and hold you a prisoner of that situation, because your heart is not assured and your heart is not established. Am I teaching good? Yeah. Your heart be established on Christ. I love Jesus. I got some soul lifting emails and I've asked them to print. If time permits me, I'll read a few of them for you. There are so many. From people watching and listening to these messages, and deliverance and restoration, healing and life is coming alive. Just listening. Focus is getting right. Confusion vanishing, evaporating. Why? The doctrine of Christ liberates men. Am I teaching here? I am come that you may have life. Outside Christ, no life. Religion is a whitewashed sepulcher. It is a grave that money has been used to prepare the coffin, but inside this expensive coffin is rotting bones. That's religion. Outside Christ is religion. Even if it's a church, if Christ is not there, it's a religious social club. Hiya. God punish Satan. When we say imagine Jesus, don't imagine an idol. Because some of you, when we say now, set your heart on Christ, set your mind on Jesus, you imagine a man on top of a tree. That image is an idol, because that's not Jesus you're seeing. That picture you are seeing on top of the cross with nail and blood pouring, that's not Jesus. That is an idol. Wahala de ground. If it's not Jesus, it can never be God. So anything outside Jesus is idol worship. I was sharing with my guys who fix our CDs and who record our messages. He came to get some topics from me and I was sharing with him. I said to him, do you know why we say if he's not Jesus, he cannot be God? He was looking at me. Because there are some of you, even up to now, you have not understood. You wonder why we are making much ado about it. It's not a new cliche we have discovered. We are not flabbergasted by a coinage. Every religion in the world believes in God. All. Buddha, Muslim, Guru Maharaj, Olumba Obu, call them. They all believe it. They have no problem with God. All religions believe that there is somebody up there called God. All religions, no controversy. The controversy of all religion is who is the access. That's where the controversy is. The matter is not God. That a church is preaching God doesn't make it a church. The controversy is Islam say it's Muhammad. And Muhammad, Islam say it's a prophet. Guru Maharaj say he's the one. Olumba Obu say he's the Holy Spirit. I'm teaching now. All the religions have somebody, but all of them say we are searching for the way. All of them say we are prophets. Jesus showed up and said, he that has seen me has seen the Father. I am the face of the Father. Without me, nobody can reach the Father. So if it is not Jesus, it can never. I didn't say it cannot. Even in another world, in the world past, in the world present, in the world to come, if it is not Jesus, it can never be God. Never. I don't care how many times they are calling God there. If Jesus is not attached to that God, it's not the same God. The God I serve is not the same that the Muslims are serving. Because the God of the Muslims is accessed by Muhammad. And Jesus said, no man has ever seen the Father. Sit down, let's get back to our subject. That was just a side dish. I just gave you orange juice. So we continue with the main food. Hold your neighbor's leg. Say, if it is not Jesus, it can never be God. So, you go to some churches, they preach everything else minus Jesus because they don't know him. They preach everything. They preach deliverance. They preach morality. They preach all kinds of motivation. How to make money. Success. They preach everything. The only thing that that church don't know is they don't know Jesus. So, it cannot be God in that place. No, it means that place is secularism. There's a religion called secularism. Some churches, the most of Jesus they know is for prayer in the name of Jesus. Finish. Outside that, they don't know him. So they don't know God. You wonder why all we're doing here is Jesus? That is the message. Without Jesus, you don't know God. Are you hearing me now? Leave that side. Come back here first. Come back here. Come back here. Are you here? I said, come back here. Are you here? Lift your right hand and say, if it is not Jesus, it can never be God. He said, no man can come to the Father. No man. What are you talking about? It's not Mary we are talking about. Holy Mary, pray for us. The God that Mary accesses is not the same God I serve. I'm talking now. The God that Mary will access is not the same God I serve. And that's not to disrespect Mary. We respect her for being the one that was used for the incarnation. But that's it. She has finished playing her part. Just like anybody else played their part in helping to bring Christ and the purpose of Christ to fulfillment. But outside that, that is idolatry. It's idol worship. Anything that connects you with God that is not Jesus is an idol. And we know that there are no idols. So that means there is no connection. Why are you fighting? I'm fighting because there is a lot of noise everywhere. People are confused. They don't know the gospel. This is the gospel. No man can access God without Jesus. So if you don't know Jesus, you don't know God. That's why the doctrine of Christ is the only doctrine that the entire gospel recognizes. The entire preaching of the gospel is summarized in one word, the doctrine of Christ. And he said, anybody that hath not this doctrine, he said, don't wish him farewell. If you tell him Godspeed, the evil he's doing, you will be a partaker. He said, don't bring them to your house. With doctrines of devils, don't bring them to your house. Don't bring them to your house. People gather and say, let's pray, let's pray. We will pray through this one. You will pray through that one. At least the important thing is that we all believe in God. Now lie. We don't all believe in God. You believe in an idol. I believe in Jesus. Jesus is God. Jesus is God. Jesus is God. Jesus is God. And if your heart can't take that, you're not born again. Because no man can call Jesus Lord save by the Holy Ghost. And if it's annoying you that we're calling Jesus too much, you need to be born again. If you're not excited about Jesus, you need to be born again. Eh? No man can come. The face of God. Jesus, the face of God. Jesus, the face of God. The express face of God. I can close this service up. Jesus, the express face of God. We see Jesus. How many of you see Jesus tonight? Wave your hand, shout, I see Jesus. Let's go back, Joe. Let's go back. So how do you assure your heart? By considering what Jesus has done. Paul said, so somebody will say, so if I want to imagine Jesus, what do I imagine? Imagine the word. When we say imagine Jesus, what should come to your mind is, surely he has borne our griefs. That's what should come to your mind, not a picture. It is what he has said that should come, because he is the word. So to imagine Jesus, you imagine the word. You picture something like, by his stripes I am healed. You imagine he was wounded. You imagine he came as a ransom. You imagine those scriptures, not picture. That picture. You ponder on what his word says. I'm born of God. I'm born of God. Some people say, I saw a vision. Many people's vision come out of their conscience. See all kinds of funny things. I heard about a woman some years ago who said she went to heaven and saw that they are still building houses in heaven with cement. Any heaven that cement is used for building is not heaven. It's not heaven. Thousands of people, millions of people are following that confused lady. Totally confused. Totally confused. What kind of heaven? Which cement? Dangote cement? Paul said, if an angel come from heaven, did you hear that? Come from where? He didn't say if an angel come from here. He said, if an angel, Galatians chapter 1, verse 6, 7, 8, 9, if an angel come from heaven and tell you anything other than the doctrine of Christ, let him be accursed. Curse him. Paul said, even we, if we come back again and tell you anything that contradict this one, let us be accursed. Then in 1 Corinthians, is this 1 or 2 Corinthians 11, 4, he said there is another Jesus. There is another Jesus. Then he said there is another spirit. So that some people are calling Jesus, you need to check which Jesus are they calling. Because anyone that said Jesus did not come in flesh is not from God. These are fundamentals. So solid foundations we're sharing with you. That you had a dream and you saw some flying objects doesn't mean it's God. It could be your conscience fabricating images because of what you've been taught, because of the doctrine you were exposed to, because of some wrong teaching that formed your conscience. So based on that, it constituted your belief system, and based on that, it brought out the images that you're seeing. That's why your heart should be established with grace. With grace. That's why I'm laboring like this. To get you established with grace. You won't fail. You'll fix your thoughts on the present day ministry of Jesus. That's where to fix your thought. What he has done. If it's a worship song, that worship song has to be on Jesus and what he has done. All these materialistic connected songs are not the songs we should be singing. Our song should be on what he has done, how he has died, what he has gotten for us by his death, his burial, and his resurrection. That's the whole gospel. Anything outside that, we need to examine where you yourself are coming from. He is the high priest of the church. Looking unto Jesus. Fix your heart on the scriptures. He's at the right hand of the Father. Glory to God. reassure your heart. He's at the right hand of the Father. He ever liveth there to make intercession for me. He ever liveth to walk in me, to walk in me that which is perfect. He ever liveth to save me to the uttermost. I come to him by faith. You assure your heart with that. When the devil tell you are not qualified, tell him, I was never, I am not, I can never be, but he has qualified me. You establish your heart. You assure your heart. Somebody say, I assure my heart. Say it again, I assure my heart by the finished work of Christ. That's right. You assure your heart. Don't let nobody deceive you. You assure your heart. You assure your hearts. So you must diligently confess his office and his finished work. You must diligently, you didn't hear that English. You must diligently confess his office and his finished work. Not your weaknesses. You don't confess your weaknesses. You confess the office of Jesus and the finished work of Jesus. Not your weaknesses. But that's what religion has taught, that you confess your weaknesses. No, you don't confess your weaknesses. You confess the finished work of Christ. You confess what he has done for you. And you confess what he is doing for you now at the right hand of the Father. That's what to confess. There's nothing else to confess. Amen. In the epistles, we confess Christ and his works. That's the confession of the believer in the epistles, which is the family album. We confess Christ and his works. That's our confession. We don't confess our weaknesses. We don't confess our mistakes. There is no such thing in the epistles. In the epistles, which is the family album, he tells us to confess Christ. How did you get born again? You confess Jesus and that God raised him from the dead and you are saved. Irrespective of how dirty you are, when you confess Jesus, it cleansed you. So even in the faith, you keep confessing Jesus, because as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him, rooted and grounded. Colossians chapter 2 verse 6. Put it up. Colossians chapter 2 verse 6. Colossians chapter 2 verse 6. As you have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him. How did you receive him? By confessing his death, burial, and resurrection. How do you walk in him? By confessing his death, burial, and resurrection. When you walk in him, he says you will be rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding therein with what? Thanksgiving. You keep confessing what he has done for you and you give thanks. You confess what he has done for you, you give thanks. You confess what he has done for you, you give thanks. Why? That is how to be rooted. That is how to be grounded. And that is how to assure our hearts. Shout, I hear you.
I hear you.
That's right. That's how to be rooted. Any other confession you're confessing will unroot you. If it's English, uproot, uproot, unroot, uproot, enroot. All things that have to do with rooting. You received him by faith. You confessed him as Lord. You continue the journey confessing him as Lord. When you fail, you confess him as your righteousness. When you make mistake, you confess him as your holiness. When you are imperfect, you confess him as your perfection. Somebody says nonsense about you, you confess him as your sanctification. You are assuring your heart. You are what? Assuring your heart. You walk in him rooted. You walk in him grounded. So in the epistles, we do not confess sin. We confess the finished work. In the epistles, we do not confess sin. We confess the finished work. We confess his finished work. In the epistles. Hebrews 13:15. By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. That is the fruit of our lips. What is this fruit of our lips? The sacrifice of praise, not the confession of sin. The sacrifice of praise, praising him for what he has done. And that is the fruit of our lips. Hebrews chapter 3 verse 1. We are for holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling. Consider Jesus the high priest, the apostle and high priest of our confession. What is our confession? Jesus. We confess Jesus. We don't confess sin. If you shall believe in your heart the Lord Jesus and confess with your mouth that God raised him from the dead, that's the confession of the believer. The confession of the believer is not sin. The confession of the believer is Jesus and his finished work. See, I hear you. Teaching good here. We confess with thanksgiving. We confess Jesus and his finished work. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 14. Hebrews chapter 10 verse 23. All of it keeps telling you to confess, to confess. The word confess is the Greek word homologio. Homologous means say something that your heart agrees with. To say something that your heart agrees with. That is to say, your heart and your mouth are in consent. They agree together. So our confession, therefore, is what Christ has done in my heart and in my mouth. What Christ has done. We deal with sin consciousness when we begin to confess Jesus and his finished work. Amen. A lot of people live with daily consciousness that is fed with sin. You pray and the answer has not come. The next thing Satan tells you is because there's a sin, a consciousness. That you pray and the answer has not come means that doesn't mean there is sin. That you pray and the answer has not manifested doesn't mean you've done something wrong. You are supposed to stay in faith giving thanks. You keep giving thanks until the answer comes. And if you stay there, the answer will come. What are you talking about? I've been in this journey for years. I can tell you it always comes. It always comes. He that will come and will not tarry. It always comes. There is no even thinking supposing. There is no supposing. It comes or it comes or it comes or it comes. There's no other way. All the promises of God in him. Where are you? Yeah. What is yeah? Yes. What is yes? Agree. What is amen? So be it. All the promises. Not some of them. In him, where you are, there are yes and amen. There is no, you know, they used to teach you, sometimes when you pray, God says, wait. And some other times, God says, no. And some other times, God says, yes. It's fallacy. Total fallacy is the doctrine of devils. All the promises of God in him are yes, amen. There's no wait and there is no no. Why? Because all the promises of God are completed in Christ. Christ has finished it. And because it is built on his finished work, it is yes and amen. There is no two ways about it. We stay there. We keep our minds. We are sure of our hearts. We do what? We're sure of our hearts. Some people tell you, before you pray, you have to confess your sins. That is a doctrine of devils. It's not scriptural. In the epistles, we don't confess sin. We confess what Jesus has done. We confess his lordship. We confess his finished work. Because the basis for our acceptance is what he did. And that's what we keep confessing. That's what we keep projecting. And that's where we stand. We stand in this grace. Where do we stand? We stand in this grace. We stand in this grace. We don't stand in our ability. We stand inside this grace. Saved by grace. We stand in this grace. And we walk in this grace. Glory to God. Yes. And we rejoice. When we stay in the grace, we rejoice. In the grace, it's only rejoicing. If you find a brother not rejoicing, his heart has shifted. He has shifted from grace to meat. He has moved to meat. When you move to meat, you lack rejoicing. When you move to meat, condemnation comes. But when you stay in this grace, you rejoice. steadily. You don't have mood swings. You don't have mood swings. A little bit happy, small time depressed. You are just like that. You are never stable. You are far from being established in grace. Men that are established in grace, they rejoice all the time. All the time. All the time. In and out of season. Consistently, constantly, constant. Steady. We stand in this grace. We walk in this grace. We live in this grace. Glory to God. We rejoice. Anybody rejoicing here? We rejoice in the hope of the glory, even the glory of God, which is Christ in you. Praise the Lord. Woo-wee. Amen. James chapter 1 verse 6 begins to deal with a double mind. A double mind is a mind that views God as a schizophrenic character. Sometimes he's happy, sometimes he's sad. That's a mind that is not assured. And that's a mind that is not established with grace. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. Let not that man think he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in some of his ways. All. He will be unstable in marriage. He will be unstable in business. He will be unstable in career. He will be unstable in everything he does. Why? His mind is double-minded. His mind thinks that God can punish me and God is good. So because his mind is double-minded, he views God as a dual character. So his heart is not assured. So he doesn't come to God in full assurance of faith. So what happens? He cannot receive anything from the Lord. So that's why John said we assure our hearts. A double-minded mind say, well, because I used to be a bad person, I don't think God will bless me. A double-minded man is a man that has not been established in grace. Unstable. In all. And let not that man even think it. Let him not even think. Even though Jesus has paid the price, but since he has not been assured of what Jesus has done, he can't draw from what has been done. He can't. He cannot draw. Don't say, I've been a Christian, I don't know why things are tough. Are you established in grace? Is your heart established on the finished work of Christ? If it is, you will not be complaining. You're complaining because you're double-minded. You think that God is delaying. Since I became a Christian, when I pray, it takes God time. The God of the Old Testament was faster than the God of the New Testament. You are a double-minded man. You can never receive anything from the Lord. Let not that man, let him not think. Don't even think about it. Don't even think. First of all, he didn't say don't pray. It is after thinking you pray. He said, don't even think. That's to say, don't even pray. Because your prayer is a waste of time. Double-minded. This man is not established with grace. I'm teaching good here. That's why if you're not here last week when we dealt with the true nature of God, if you're not, go and buy all the CDs, sit down with them. Because they will deliver you from double-mindedness. Some of us are double-minded, we don't know we are. It is teaching that brings you to understand why things are working the way they are working and why they are not working the way they are working. See, let not that man. Today God is good, tomorrow God is evil. Let not that man think he shall receive anything because that man is double-minded. James 1:13. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempted he any man. Let not that man who is double-minded think, because God does not tempt people and God is not behind evil. When you think God can do evil and do good, you're double-minded. So now James is showing you what double-mindedness could mean. Next verse, 14. But every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and is enticed. 15. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. 16. Do not err, my beloved brethren. Do not err. Understand what we're talking about and deliver yourself from error. Don't err. Don't say things that you don't know. Don't build your life on rumor. Don't err, my brethren. Every good and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights. Lights. Not the Father of darkness. The Father of lights. 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 It cometh from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variations. He doesn't treat some people one kind and treat another people one kind. No variableness in him. And there's no shadow of turning. That is, he doesn't have the shadow talking of the reality. Do you understand? There's no shadow of turning with him. He doesn't change. The same yesterday, today, and forever. He said, don't err, my brethren. Don't err. Don't say it is God that killed your junior brother. Don't err. That's error. Don't err. God does not kill. Even if your junior brother was a prayer warrior and he died in a period of 40-day fasting, it was not God. God didn't kill him in fasting. How will God make you stay with him and kill you? God is not a killer. He's a life giver. Oh, yeah. I am come that they might have life. Every good and every perfect gift comes from above. Teaching good? Yes, say, don't err. Don't err. Don't enter error. Be established in grace. Every good and every perfect gift coming from above. It coming from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, nor a shadow of turning. A shadow of what? Of turning. A shadow of what? Of turning. Verse 18. Look at it. Now, after talking about God, and he said, of his own will begat he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruit of his creature. Verse 19. Wherefore, my blood brethren, knowing what we have said, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. Don't talk anyhow. Now that you know that good things come from God, don't talk anyhow. Don't join people to say, the Lord did it. Be slow. Next verse. For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Next verse, 21. Wherefore, lay apart, having understood the nature of God, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness. Let me break that one down. All filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your soul. Glory to God. The word lay apart is the Greek word apotesi. It's apotetheme. It means to renounce a thought in your heart. To lay apart means to renounce a thought in your heart. To renounce a thought. To cancel a thought that is coming to your heart. You renounce it. That's what it means by lay apart. And when he say lay apart, it is you that will lay apart. It is not God that will lay it apart. So when Satan is bringing that thought, you denounce it. You cancel the thought. You strike it. You cast it down. You shut it down. Ephesians 4:25 tells you that. Hebrews 12:1 tells you that. 1 Peter 2:1 tells you that. And 2 Corinthians chapter 7 verse 1. 2 Corinthians 7 verse 1. He says, lay, set apart. Set apart. Set apart. Laying apart all filthiness. The word filthiness is the Greek word rufaria. It is R-H-U-P-A-R-I-A. Rufaria. It means pollution. Filthiness means pollution. A filth. Pollution or a filth. Pollution. That's the meaning of filthiness. Lay apart all pollution. The word superfluity means wickedness. Lay apart all pollution and wickedness. And wickedness is taken from the root word wicked. It means twisted. When you call light darkness, and you call darkness light, when you say God is the author of evil, you are a wicked man. You are twisted. Wickedness means to be twisted. To say God is the one that killed people makes you a wicked person. You're twisted. You're trying to call God darkness. I'm teaching. I said I'm teaching. Look at the next verse. Look at the next verse. Verse 21. 21. Wherefore lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your soul. Verse 22. but be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. Deceiving who? Your own self. Is the Greek word paralogismo. Paralogismo means to act beside who you are, to pretend to be who you are not. Paralogismo, to act beside who you are. Deceiving yourself, acting a script that is not your own, acting beside yourself. Deceiving yourself means this is who you are, but you're pretending to be something else. You are righteous, but you're pretending to be a sinner. Paralogismo, you are deceiving yourself. You are holy, but you are pretending to be a liar. You are suffering from paralogismo. You are acting beside yourself. You are acting a script that is not your own. Touch your neighbor's leg and say, lay apart, lay apart. Put away all those things. Now look at the last verse I want to read. Tomorrow we continue verse 25. James 1, 25, 25, 25. James 1. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty. The perfect law of liberty is the law of righteousness. Is the law of the finished work of Christ. Focusing on Christ. When you focus on Christ, you cannot accommodate filthy thoughts. When you look into the perfect law of liberty, you are not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work. When you look into that law, all you see is Christ. But if you don't continue looking at that law, you will come to Power City and hear you are the righteousness of God. You will go out and see billboard arresting the arrestor. You will go for that program. So you forget who you are for a moment, going to arrest the arrester. You come back tomorrow, we teach another one. You are holy in him. You go back out, you see another program, killing Pharaoh. You go and attend. Where is Pharaoh in Christ? Where is Pharaoh in Christ? You come again, you hear another one. You are a world overcomer. You go out and see another program. Give me a spouse or I die. So Lord, I will die if you don't give me a spouse. So you come again, you see, you are complete in him who is the head of all principalities and powers. You go out and see billboard. Freedom from generational curses to the 30th generation. You're sitting in front. What's your problem? You are looking into the perfect law, but you are not continuing therein. So therefore, you are a double-minded man. You are both righteous and unrighteous. You are both holy and arresting the arrester. You are both sanctified and killing Pharaoh. You are both complete and giving a husband or I die. You are paralogismo. You are suffering from self-deception. But I declare tonight, you stay in the perfect law. You keep looking at that law and keep seeing what Christ has done. Somebody jump on your feet and shout, I am complete in him who is the head of all devils. I'm a new creation. I am born of God. I have the seed of God. I have the life of God. I have the nature of God. I am a son of God. I am accepted in the beloved. I am righteous. I am holy in his sight. There is no failure around me. I am blessed to be a blessing. My future is guaranteed. I am looking into the perfect law and I see myself perfect. Accepted. I see myself complete. I see myself standing in the grace of God. I see myself blessed. I cannot be cursed. I see myself no generational curse, only generational blessing. I see myself. I'm in him. He's in me. I'm in him. Justified. He's in me. Glorified. I see myself complete in him. I am the apple of his eye. I see myself complete in him. I am bone of his bones and flesh of his flesh. What cannot be found in him cannot be found in me. I am blessed beyond the curse. Shout amen, somebody. Lift your right hand. I prophesy over you tonight. By reason of the finished work of Christ, whatever does not look like Jesus is terminated in your life, terminated in your family, terminated in your career. You're lifted, you will never come down. Your focus is Christ. See Jesus. See Jesus. See Jesus. See Jesus. It is done. Done, done, done. In Jesus' mighty name. Go ahead and celebrate what Jesus has done. That's not a complete celebration. We assure our hearts. Celebrate, celebrate. We assure our hearts. Hey! We assure our hearts. Somebody shout, I assure my heart. No condemnation. I am righteous, holy, perfect, acceptable in his sight. Amen. You can be seated in heaven.